Hello friends, welcome to my channel. So today in this video lecture, we're going to study about syndromes which are associated with developmental disturbances. There might be many additional etiological factors behind these syndromes, but mainly it would be of developmental disturbances. So before starting the lecture, if you are new to the channel, please consider subscribing it, and you can follow me on Instagram and Facebook where we do daily image-based questions. It will help you to strengthen your concepts and revise topics better. To get a free PDF of any of the video lectures, you can get it from my Telegram channel. And all the links are in the description box below. So any further ado, let's get started. So today we are going to study about facial hemiatrophy. Guys, pay attention to the other names of this syndrome. Okay, it is also known as Peri-Romberg or Romberg-Peri, or progressive hemiatrophy, or progressive hemifacial atrophy, right? Second syndrome which we are going to study is Vanderwood syndrome, then Melkerson-Rosenthal syndrome, Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, and Gardner syndrome. These five syndromes are mainly of importance when we study about the developmental disturbances part, right? So in facial hemiatrophy, which is famously known as Peri-Romberg syndrome, it was first reported by Romberg, so it's called Peri-Romberg, right? And Peri is also the name of one of the clinician only. It's a slowly progressive atrophy of the soft tissues of essential half of the face, which includes fat, atrophy of the skin, cartilage, bone, and muscles. It is confined to one side of the face and cranium mostly. That's why we call it hemiatrophy, right? Because it is confined to only one side. Usually, it is accompanied by contralateral Jacksonian epilepsy, trigeminal neuralgia, and changes in the eyes and hair. Guys, this point is very important considering your MCQs, so please note it down. And it is also a localized form of scleroderma, okay? This is the image directly taken from the Schaeffer's, okay? In image-based questions also, they can put the similar image taken from the textbook, so it will help you identify it, right? So this is the facial hemiatrophy. You can mark out the atrophy on this side of the face, right? We'll see the clinical features in detail. Coupe de sabre near the midline of the face or forehead. Guys, what is coupe de sabre? This word you will also see while studying the scleroderma, okay? It is a localized form of scleroderma or a deep lining or a furrow on the face, okay? It basically distinguishes the normal from the abnormal side of the face. Then this marks the boundary between normal and the atrophic tissue, as I said. Then bluish hue may appear in the skin overlying the atrophic fat. Female to male ratio is 3:1, so it is mainly seen in female, and slight predilection is for the left side. It appears in first and second decades of the life. This point is important, and also keep in mind it is more in female, and coupe de sabre is peculiar feature of this Peri-Romberg, okay? Next syndrome is Vanderwood syndrome. It is also known as cleft lip syndrome, lip pit syndrome, or dimpled papillae of the lip. Guys, this is the image from the Schaeffer's, and here you can see the dimpled papillae of the lip, okay, or Vanderwood syndrome, and it is associated with cleft. This here you can mark out, right? It is inherited as autosomal dominant. Hallmark of Vanderwood syndrome is the association of cleft lip and or cleft palate and distinctive pits of the lower lip, which means pits on the lower lip, it has to be there, and either cleft lip or cleft palate or both of which will be present, okay? These three peculiar conditions are seen with Vanderwood syndrome. due to abnormal fusion of the palate and lips, as we have studied in our cleft and lip lecture, right? And it mainly occurs during the 30 to 50 days post-conception, right? It can be caused by deletion of chromosome band 1q32. It is the position of this gene, okay? It's the locus, which we describe it like this way, 1q32. Q is the arm of the chromosome. So this is important for our MCQ. It affects both the genders equally. Guys, here you can mark out very easily the lip pits, okay, and the cleft, which is just involving the soft palate. And here in the picture, you can classically see the cleft lip and palate both along with the lip pits. So this is, even if in the image-based question, you could be able to identify it very easily that it is nothing else but the Van der Woodt syndrome, okay? Next is Melkerson-Rosenthal syndrome. Cheilitis occurs with facial palsy, which is of lower motor neuron type and plicated tongue. So there are three characteristics of this syndrome. First is cheilitis, okay, which is cracked lips, okay, and along with the facial palsy, which is of lower motor neuron type and plicated tongue. Now, variation of which is Mischer cheilitis. It is the term used when the granulomatous changes are confined to the lip. It is generally monosymptomatic form of the Melkerson-Rosenthal syndrome, okay? This is some new information which I found in Schaeffer's. I haven't seen any MCQs regarding this, but please do note it down, okay? And this syndrome is occasionally a manifestation of Crohn's disease or orofacial granulomatosis. All these three points are extremely important regarding Melkerson-Rosenthal syndrome, okay? So here we have easy mnemonic, which is MRF, okay? Melkerson-Rosenthal associated with facial palsy. So I said it as MRF, okay? Whereas our Perry Romberg was associated with trigeminal neuralgia. To avoid this confusion, we have an easy mnemonic, which is MRF. So Melkerson-Rosenthal, facial palsy is seen with it, okay? Not trigeminal neuralgia, clear? Here in the image, you can see the cheilitis, okay, and plicated tongue appearance. And in this image, you can see the facial palsy, okay, which is of lower motor neuron type. Then comes the Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. It is also inherited as autosomal dominant, and it is characterized by intestinal hematomatous polyps in association with mucocutaneous melanocytic macules. Two peculiarity of Peutz-Jeghers is intestinal hematomatous polyps, okay, which we will see in the image, it would become more clear. And the second peculiarity is what? Macules, okay, mucocutaneous macules, which means macules are present on our skin as well as on the mucous membranes. Mucous membranes mainly involving our oral cavity and intestine, okay. There are increased risk of developing cancer of gastrointestinal tract, including pancreas and luminal organs, are our small and large intestine and reproductive tract and lungs, okay. It is named after Peutz and Jeghers. So here you can see this macules around perioral region. And here in the second image, you can see the polyps, okay? This syndrome appears to be germline mutation of STK11 gene. Guys, this is an important MCQ. You have to remember it and please note it down, okay? So the gene responsible for Peutz-Jeghers is STK11 gene in most cases, and it is located on 19p13.3. It's okay if you don't remember the locus, but the gene you have to remember it, okay? And it has equal distribution in both the sexes, and age of diagnosis is 23 to 26 years, okay? Mainly midlife mein. And it has positive familial history also. Also, this syndrome can be asked as in the form of case presentation, okay? Seeing the current paper style, it can be it can come as a case presentation. So how it would look like, patient is presenting complaint including repeated bouts of abdominal pain in patient younger than 25 years, unexplained intestinal bleeding or menstrual irregularities in female. Okay, if such symptoms are described in your question, then it is none other than Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. Okay, first thing which they will mention is bout of abdominal pain, right? Second thing is age, 25 years, and they will say about they will describe about intestinal bleeding and menstrual irregularities in female. Okay, so all this is characteristic of Peutz-Jeghers. Cutaneous pigmentation, as you can see, which is of 1 to 5 mm macules, okay, of the perioral region crossing the vermilion border, perinasal and perioral areas is seen. And mucous membrane pigmentation primarily affects the buccal mucosa. Such type of peculiar macules are seen with this syndrome. Now the last one is Gardner syndrome, in which multiple polyposis of the large intestine. Main characteristic is osteomas of the bone including the long bones, skull and jaws, multiple epidermoid or sebaceous cyst of the skin, particularly on the scalp and back, occasional occurrence of desmoid tumor. Guys, what are desmoid tumor? Actually, desmoid tumor may occur anywhere in the body, okay, in the abdominal or intra-abdominal or extra-abdominal location, okay. Impacted supernumerary or permanent teeth are also seen with Gardner syndrome, and it is inherited as autosomal dominant. So in Gardner syndrome there are five characteristics which you need to pay attention to, okay. First, there would be a multiple polyposis of large intestine. Then second is osteomas of the bone including long bones, skull and jaws. Third thing, epidermoid or sebaceous cyst. Fourth, occasional occurrence of desmoid tumors. And fifth is impacted supernumerary or permanent teeth. All these five characteristics you have to remember for Gardner syndrome. It is very important. So here, this is the direct image from Schaeffer's, okay. It mainly shows the osteomas of the bone, okay. And in this picture, you can see the polyposis of the intestine. Here we can also see the multiple osteomas, okay, you can identify it very easily. And this is the case of Gardner syndrome in Indian patient, and in this panoramic radiograph you would be able to see the multiple osteomas of the bone, okay, and multiple impacted teeth and osteomas would be more clear in the next picture, okay. In this picture we cannot identify it much clearly, but yeah, in the clinical presentation we can see here. So this is the panoramic image of Gardner syndrome, and guys, here you can see such small radio opacities. Yeah, these are the osteomas which are related with mandible, okay. All these are showing the osteomas of the bone. And there are high chances of supernumerary teeth and extra permanent teeth as well, okay. So this was all about it. See you soon in the next lecture.